the Most High. Yes, you are the Lord, 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 the Most High. Yes, you are Jesus, the Most High. Yes, you are Jesus, the Most High. Yes, you are Jesus, the Most High. Yes, you are the Lord, the Most High.
Father, we give you praise and glory. Father, just give him thanks. Father, we give you praise. For this is the day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you because you're a good Father. Thank you, Father, for we know in Christ Jesus we are not without hope and without God in this world. We'll give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Good afternoon. Hallelujah. Welcome to Healing School again. This is Rema Nigeria Daily Healing School. Can I have a little more volume, please? Thank you. It's Rema Nigeria Daily Healing School. We meet here. Jesus the healer, and he heals the sick. And we are living proofs that his word works. We are living proofs that he heals the sick. So I don't care the sickness you have in your body. I don't care what the doctors have told you. All I have to tell you is that there is a good news that came to mankind when Jesus came on earth. In Luke chapter 2, the angel said, glory be to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill towards all men. What is that good? So Jesus is God's goodwill towards mankind. And he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. So in expressing God's goodwill towards mankind, Jesus went about healing every sick person. Hallelujah. So I have good news for you. No matter what they've told you, if you can just understand and agree with us and agree with God, not even with us, agree with God, he will take your healing. Matthew chapter 8. He went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. And the same, that's Jesus is God's goodwill to mankind. Matthew chapter 8 verse 16. See what he says here. He says, when the even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word and healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sickness. Can we say that together? Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. One more time, please. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. There was a woman, Brother Higgin, met that was, I think, if I remember well, she was 82 years old. She had been a good Christian. She was now 82 years old and she had cancer. And they said she was going to die. And Regan said, well, you can let God heal you, then die if you want to, because himself took your infirmities and bore your sicknesses. So he gave her God's word, stayed with her for some time, kept giving her God's word. She got healed. I think she died at the age of 93 instead of 82, free of cancer. So it doesn't matter the age you are, himself took your infirmities and bore your sicknesses. An 82-year-old woman, if she's not born again, still needs to get born again. Is that not so? A 95-year-old man that has not accepted the gospel needs to accept the gospel and receive Jesus. But part of the gospel is healing for your body. So we've been talking for some time about that, just emphasizing over and over again. Let me just read that Matthew 8:16 again. When even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word and healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. So Jesus healed all to fulfill the scriptures. And he's still fulfilling those scriptures in our lives today, once we accept them as true. So we've been talking about what we normally call Christ the healer. That's what we talk about. That's the main purpose we call topic. We see, the first thing we talked about, we've talked about reasons why we know it is God's will for us to be healed. And I mentioned so many reasons that God is love, God is good. And because healing is both in the New Testament and the Old Testament, and God has not changed. He's still the same God with the same story. We talked about that healing is God's will because healing is the children's bread. It's God's will for you, not just God's will generally. God's will for me, God's will for you. Because you know, you can believe that, hey, God can do it for anybody, but he will not do it for me. No, that's not what we're talking about. We are talking about you and I. That healing is always God's will for me. Healing is always God's will for you. That's what we're talking about. So we said that, why is that? Because healing is the children's bread. Healing is what? The children's bread. So, and I mentioned Matthew chapter 15, verse 21. We went through that. I don't think I want to go back there again. Then we said Jesus is the express, is the will of God in action. When you see Jesus, you've seen God. And Bible says Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. We can read that. It said, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power. Jesus, the express image, brightness of his glory and the express image of the person of God. Verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. So when you've seen Jesus, you've seen God in action. So Jesus went about healing the sick. That means God is going about healing the sick. Actually, in Christ Jesus, you have been healed since the day Jesus died and rose from the dead. We are just finding about it. Praise God. Your healing has been paid for. Then we went to that. We said, of course, because of the Father heart of God, that healing is always God's will. Because it's a Father. Matthew chapter 7 says, if you then being evil, not to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father that is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? Then we went to number 6. We said healing is always God's will because of the promises of God. Because of the promises of God. I'm just taking some. I don't want to go through everything step by step again because I want to move to some. I want to go further. And after that, we've talked about things that stop, can hinder us from receiving our healing. We've said walking in bitterness and unforgiveness can hinder us from receiving our healing. And then we now want to focus on the rest of the month, most likely, on methods of obtaining healing. Hallelujah. Methods of obtaining healing. And to start that, I said, God is a faith God. God is what? A faith God. God is a faith God. What is faith? Hebrews 11:1 says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. God is a faith God. So to receive from God, anything from God, it takes faith. Out of the 19 individual stories about people that received from Jesus, the widow, the woman with the issue of blood, the centurion for his servant, the nobleman for his son, Jairus for his daughter, the sufficient woman for her daughter, the two blind men, blind Bartimaeus, the man born by four, out of the 19 cases, the man that was blind, I said, was born blind, told him to go and wash in the pool, Siloam, the man that was deaf and dumb, out of the 19 individual cases that were mentioned in the Bible about Jesus' healing, personal healing ministry, not crusade ground, when the Bible says he healed them all, that's different. Personal healing ministry. Only out of them, at least 12 of them, it was inferred that their faith was involved. It was inferred that their faith was involved. That means it takes faith to receive from God. Hebrews 11:11 says that by faith, Sarah herself received strength to conceive. It takes faith to receive from God. And many times, what is stopping people from receiving is because they don't know how faith works. Hallelujah. What is stopping people from receiving? Because they don't know how faith works. How does faith work? Faith is acting on God's word as though it is true. As though God did not lie. That is all about us. That's a simple definition of what faith is. Acting on God's word, believing that God, what God said is true, because God is not a man that should lie. John chapter 4, let me show us something. The methods of obtaining healing. John chapter 4. I will start from verse 46. Yeah. So Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went into him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son. For he was at the point of death. Then said Jesus unto him, except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. The nobleman said unto him, John chapter 4, I'm in verse 49 now. The nobleman said unto him, sir, come down ere my child die. Jesus said unto him, go your way, your son lives. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, thy son liveth. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend. And they said unto him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. The fever did what? Left him. See what happened? So the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, thy son liveth, himself believed, and his whole household, in his whole house. This is again the second miracle that Jesus did when he was come out of Judea into Galilee. This man came to meet Jesus. Come and lay hands on my son so he will not die. Jesus said, except as you see guys, see one's wonders, won't you believe? The man said, don't waste time, my son is about to die. And Jesus said, go. Jesus shifted the man from sense only to faith immediately. Jesus said, go, your son liveth. And the man believed and went his way. That is what faith is. Faith is believing God's word and going your way. Believing God's word and going your way. If he says you are healed, you believe. Because before we start looking at these methods, we must say to this, that any of the methods you act on, there's only one that doesn't include faith, really. It's the one of mansion of the spirit, is as the spirit wills. But every other of the six methods that you have acted on, once you act on it, you go your way. You go your way. Because God's word is anointed. God's word has enough power to be miracles into your body. And I'm not in a rush, because we're going to take this for a whole 2 or 3 weeks. God's word has enough power to bring healing to your body. Because what is 3 weeks to knowing how to get your healing and living a life of health for the next 50, 60 years? Hallelujah. Praise God. We too were taught when we're small, young boys were taught these things, and we stayed with it until we saw it working for us. Hallelujah. Until we saw it working for us. So we are going to take our time. It takes faith to receive from God. Hallelujah. It takes faith to receive from God. So methods of healing, there are two cardinal methods where healing is obtained. And I've said it. One by faith in the word of God. Or one by the manifestation of the spirit. The one by faith could be divided into two also. Faith in the word of God or faith in the healing power of God. Well, that's why we're taking 2 or 3 weeks. We are going to take time to look at it one by one. Faith in the healing power of God. That also happens. When someone is anointed with the healing power of God, like there are people here that are anointed with the healing power of God, and they minister to you, and you can actually, many times, you actually feel that power enter you. Some start feeling a heat in their body. That's the healing power of God. But you must still come in faith to receive. And sometimes when God's approved by gifts of healings too, sometimes the sick people, by word of knowledge, say there's somebody you're being healed of breast cancer, and the person can actually feel a healing balm, like a heat or a fire burning in the breast. Or it's a heart, or your heart is being made whole. The person can actually feel something burning in his chest. That's the healing power of God. But that happens also by mission of the spirit. But there's actually when someone lays hands on you, we believe he is anointed. Jesus always said that. You believe the person is and he lays hands on you, and healing power enters your body and gets you healed. We are going to take it for next week and the next two weeks. But before we go into all these methods, there are some things I want to lay a foundation again, because I want people to take their healing. Number one, I want to tell you that, you know that your healing is already been paid for, it is yours. Your healing is already paid for, it is yours. You don't have to fight for, you don't have to struggle for, your healing is already paid for. It is yours. Jesus paid the price. You are just coming to, Bible says we are more than conquerors. Remember when he said in all these things we are more than conquerors because of him that loved us. Maybe when we're small boys, when we just got born again, they will tell us that what does it mean to be more than a conqueror? Then I think, okay, at least Muhammad Ali is well known as one of the greatest boxers of all time. So imagine Muhammad Ali has a wife and is married. He goes to fight in the ring. He wins the boxing bout, gets the belt, and the belt goes with a prize money. Gets the prize money, maybe gets a check. Then gets home and gives the wife that check or the prize money. The prize money. That wife is more than a conqueror. Because she didn't fight any war, but she got the result. She didn't fight, but she got the reward as if she entered the ring, but she didn't enter the ring. Hallelujah. He says, in all these things, we are more than conquerors because of him that loved us. That's Romans chapter 8, verse 37. So know this very well, that first, your healing has been paid for. Your healing has been paid for in Christ Jesus. God is not against you. He has paid for your healing. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. What am I doing? I'm just trying to... Now, do I need to say what I'm doing? I'm sneaking behind the back to help you be in faith to receive your healing. I should call it that way. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? How shall he not also with him freely give us all things? You see, when we have this basis of what we have in Christ, we are bold to take it. Sometimes, because of that, faith now becomes unconscious. Hallelujah. But I say, if God be for us, it doesn't matter who is against us. Because he that did not spare his only son, but gave him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? That means God is on your side. So you first know that, okay, you heard about Jesus, that he has healing power, that he heals the sick. He is the healer, he heals the sick, he raises the dead. First know, understand, that person that has all that power, he's ready to give you all things. So if he's giving you all things, that power to heal the sick is also available to you. Hallelujah. Romans, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, not who will bless us, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in every places in Christ Jesus. We have been blessed with all spiritual blessings. And I always like to link this verse to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. It says that we know that the whole world was framed by the word of God, that the things that are seen were not made of things that appear. So what we are seeing now, we're made from things that we cannot see. The chair you are sitting on was made from something that cannot see. We cannot see. It was God's word that spoke the materials into being. Let there be an earth. And that from the materials of the earth, they made the chair. Praise God. Hallelujah. The clothes you are wearing were made of things that you cannot see. All came from God's word. It was God that said, let there be, and there was. Hallelujah. So what am I saying? The same now says that he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heaven places in Christ Jesus. Because these are things that help you stay in faith to receive. When you know that, if I've been blessed with all spiritual blessings, he's not withholding any good thing from those that walk uprightly. Psalm 84. The Bible says he has blessed all spiritual blessings. The Bible says, he that spared not his only son, but gave him up for us all. How shall it not with him freely give us all things? Then my healing is a small thing. Hallelujah. My healing is a small thing because will he not with him also freely give us all things? Then my healing is not a major thing because he's giving me all things and my healing is small. The God that raised the dead, many people watching me, you don't need, your body, you are not dead, you are alive. Praise God. Even if they say your kidney is dead, if he raises a whole human being, what is kidney? He will just tap it and it comes back to life. Praise God. And you know, it's not so far from you. Hallelujah. Acts 26. So don't think that you are going to pray and God will have to come down. It's going to take a long distance for you to take your healing. No. It's very close to you. Acts 26. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name for him forever. Glory to God. In him we live and move and have our being. As he has said, some of the poets have said, we are his offspring. Sorry, Acts 17, 26. Not Acts 26. It's Acts 17, 26. As some of the poets have said, we are his offsprings. Acts 17, verse 26. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. And hath made, let me start from verse 14, 24, sorry. God that made the world, Acts 17, 24. God that made the world and all the things therein, seeing that he is Lord of all heaven and earth, dwelling not in temples made with hands. Neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he gives to all life and breath and all things. And has made of one blood all nations of men, for to dwell on the face of the earth, and has demanded the times before appointed, and the bounds of their habitations, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they may feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move, and have our being. For in him we live and move, and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offsprings. In him we live and move and have our being. So don't think as if God will have to come down from somewhere. I know right now, if you are born again, you are in Christ Jesus, that healer is now in you. Hallelujah. He's now living in you. So he's not far from you. So your healing doesn't have to take ages. Doesn't have to take 3 months. Doesn't have to take 6 years. You can act on God's word now and take it now. Let me read something to you. I want to read it straight from the notes, so I won't misquote it. You can act on God's word now and take it now. See what it says here. I want to read something about healing power. Just something about healing. Praise God. Healing is determined by two things. The degree of power administered and the degree of faith that is giving action to that power. Let me read the verbatim. Hallelujah. Healing is by degrees based on two conditions. The degree of healing power administered. That talks about when people lay hands, you understand? When someone lays hands, or someone ministers, or in a meeting, and there's a manifest presence of the healing power of God. And the degree of faith that gives action to the power. Faith that gives action to the power. But I want to dwell on that one of this degree of faith that gives action to the power. Do you know why? Because the word of God alone itself is anointed. You understand? The degree of faith that gives action to the power. The power of God is present, but faith is what gives action to that power. That's why I'm dwelling on that faith aspect. In Matthew chapter 17, I quoted Matthew chapter 17. They came to meet Jesus, to meet the disciples of Jesus. The guy had epilepsy or something. He was harassed by a demon. That's what the father said. He said, tears him and throws him into the fire oftentimes, trying to kill him. Bible says the disciples said, Matthew 17, let me read it. I brought my son to your disciples and they could not help him. Hallelujah, praise God. Verse 17, 15. Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's a lunatic. He's lunatic and so vexed, for oft times he falls into the fire and often into the water. The Mark version talks about he's afflicted by a demon that throws him into the fire and the water. And I brought him to thy disciples that they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him to me, or bring him hither. Bring him to me. Jesus said, bring him to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil and he departed out of him. And the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, why could not we cast him out? These people read the Bible well. In Matthew chapter 10, Jesus gave these people power, these disciples, to heal all manner of sicknesses and diseases. We are going to take our time these 2 weeks, and people are going to take their healing. You find where you've not been cooperating with God, and you just start cooperating and you take your healing. Jesus gave them power to heal all manner of sickness and diseases. But with all manner, they got here, they couldn't get this man healed. They now said, why couldn't we get him healed? And Jesus made a statement. He said, because of your unbelief. Verse 20. Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, move thence to yonder place, and it shall remove. And nothing shall be impossible unto you. He called it here because of unbelief. Luke chapter 5. Let's see another one. Do I like to see Luke 5? Well, Matthew 9 is better. Matthew 9. But let me read Luke 5 just to share the story. Then we'll go to Matthew 9. Luke chapter 5 verse 17. Because the degree of power administered and the degree of faith is what gives action to God's power. The degree of faith determines what happens. Hallelujah. Praise God. Luke chapter 5. Let's go there now. Look at verse 17. And he came down with them and stood in the plains, and the company of disciples, and a great multitude of people out of all Judea and Jerusalem, and from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, which came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Hallelujah. I'm reading Luke chapter 6, sorry. Luke chapter 5. And it came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with a palsy. And they sought means to bring him in, to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in, because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the thin tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. Let's jump to verse 22. But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto the man, What reason ye in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man has power upon earth to forgive sins. He said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto you, arise, take up thy couch, and go into thine house. And immediately he rose up before them, and took up that whereon he lay, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. Verse 26. And they glorified God, and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. They saw, what was the strange thing they saw? They saw a man that was born on four, that was on a stretcher, suddenly rise up and walk and go home. Hallelujah. And they said, We have seen strange things today. But you see, it was because the man came with faith. What did Jesus see? Jesus saw their faith. Matthew chapter 9. Oh, glory to God. Matthew chapter 9. See what it says. And he entered into a ship. Let me just read the same story, but see what happened now. Verse 7. Let me just read the end of the story. The same story. Matthew's version. Matthew's rendering of the same story. And he rose and departed to his own house. Jesus told him, Take care of your bed and go unto your house. Verse 7. And he rose and departed to his own house. Matthew 9, verse 8 now. But when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, which had given such power to men. Why am I bringing out? Luke 5 says that the power of God was present to heal them. Only one man was healed. That we are recorded. Why? Because that was the only man that Jesus saw his faith. The degree of faith, healing is based on two things, factors. Number one, the degree of power administered. That's if hands are laid on you, if under the anointing and all that. And then the degree of faith that gives action to that power. But I have good news for you. Another word for power is the anointing. Is that not so? The ability of God, the anointing. Isaiah 10:27 says that his burden shall be lifted off thy shoulders, the yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. I have good news for you. The word of God is anointed. So that means every time these people came into Jesus' meeting, maybe somebody came with a broken leg. Somebody came with leprosy. Another person came with a blind eye. And the power of God was present to heal them. That's what the Holy Ghost said. The Holy Ghost knew what he was saying. The power was present to heal them. But we had the record we have. Only one person went healed. Went away healed. Because it was the only one that came with faith. And when Jesus saw their faith. In Acts chapter 14, Paul went to preach in Lystra. While he was preaching in Lystra, Bible says he preached the gospel. And he saw him, but it was a man that was lame from his mother's womb, looking at him. And he perceived that the man had faith to be healed. Then he told the man, rise up and walk. So the man's faith was what gave action to God's power. The man's faith was what gave action to God's power. What was the power there? The Bible didn't say that Paul laid hands on him with the anointing. He said he heard Paul preach the gospel. The gospel is the power of God. Romans 8:16. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believed. First to the Jew and Gentile, Romans 1:16. Can you give me on the screen, please? I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Do you believe the gospel? What is the gospel? I'm going to preach the gospel again to you for the next 15 or 20 minutes. Then, but what does that gospel? Faith in that gospel will get you healed. The degree of faith. Faith in that gospel. Remember I said yesterday, find out what is the will of God about your case. Embrace that will. Faith in that gospel will get you healed. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God on the salvation. Judge power, two things, factors about healing. The degree of power administered and the faith that gives action to that power. But I'm not telling that the word of God is anointed. It's already powerful. He has all the power that is on earth. The word of God is anointed. It's powerful. It might not be in manifestation, but it is powerful. But your faith can bring it to manifestation. The woman with issue of blood in Mark chapter 5. Let's quickly read it. Let's quickly read it. It doesn't have to take forever for you to be healed. It is not God's will for you to wallow and suffer in that sickness. Two factors. The degree of power administered. But we are talking now, if it's taken in by the word, the word ready is anointed. Mark chapter 5. Let's read the story. Verse 25. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing better but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press bearing and touched his garment, for she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And disciples said unto him, thou sayest the multitude thronging thee, sayest thou who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. What I want to bring out is that, here is that. The power, Jesus was anointed with Holy Ghost, Acts 10:38. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. This woman must have heard that this man, Jesus, is anointed. And the man, woman said, if he's that anointed, all I need is touch the hem of his garment. He doesn't even need to pray for me. All I need is just to touch one part of his clothes and I'll take my healing. She came with that faith. But you know, sometimes the power might be manifestation, not manifestation. We are not told that healing power was in manifestation. But Jesus was carrying it. The woman's faith pulled it into manifestation. Yeah, I want to bring out. The woman's faith pulled it into manifestation. And it happens everywhere. Sometimes you go and minister somewhere, and the people are so experienced. I've gone to minister in different places, and some places you did the same preparation. There was one time I went to minister somewhere. Two meetings in the same day. The first place, I did the same preparation. It was the same day. I got there, and it was like a struggle to just get the word across. Why? Because most of the people didn't come with expectancy. Yes, I delivered the word. People were blessed, but it took a lot of strength to get the word across. But the other place I went to, the guy had been telling them that this guy is my pastor. When I was in university, he was my pastor. You are going to be blessed so much. So the people, as I took the mic, reverse of living water just started flowing out. Why? Because they came with expectation. They came expecting. Now, when I go for service, I pray, Father God, I make a demand on your anointing this evening. Or Sunday service, where I go, that I hear from you. I go with it, make a demand. So this woman, like when I got to that meeting, I just, from the beginning, just started flowing in tongues, it was diverse kinds of tongues, even laughing in the street. I was the same person. I just ministered in the morning, and I even traveled. It was two different towns. I even took travel for like 2.5 hours in a car, public transport, not AC, nothing. And I entered the next meeting. And so, with faith, you bring that power into manifestation in your body. Hallelujah. Praise God. The power, the word of God is anointed. So let me tell the gospel again to you again. Because the Bible says, and the woman, it was faith in the gospel that got him healed. What is the gospel? Let's start with Isaiah 53. I want to preach the gospel again. I want to preach in the next 10 minutes the gospel of healing and righteousness. To us, I just felt telling on who that some people needed to hear that again. Hallelujah. And I didn't know I was going to get there, but the Holy Ghost knew. So I'm there now. Isaiah 53, verse 1. It says, who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? He shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of the dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Hallelujah. You know, you can meditate on that, just verse 3. The word sorrows and grief is sicknesses and pains. Hallelujah. Sorrows means pains. Hallelujah. Griefs means sicknesses and diseases. So you can say he was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, a man of sickness, acquainted with sickness and pains because of me. We hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our sicknesses and carried our pains. That is the good news. Isaiah said, who has believed our report? The good news, Isaiah 53 verse 4, the literal Hebrew of that word, griefs and carried our sorrows, he has borne our sicknesses and carried our pains. He has, but the good news is that he has borne our sicknesses and carried our pains. The good news is that the day you got born again, you accept what you didn't know, you step into what Jesus had provided, in that he has borne your sicknesses and carried your pains. Let's go on, we'll see what I'm talking about. But we did assume he's speaking in the spirit of God and afflicted, verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. With his stripes we are healed. Jesus bore our sicknesses and carried our pains. The same way he bore our sins, that is what the gospel is. 1 Corinthians 3:3 talks about what the gospel is. That Jesus came, born of a boy, he died, and he rose on the third day. That is what the gospel is. And when he died, he didn't just die for himself, he died for you. Jesus bore your sicknesses and carried your pains. Verse 5 says, the chastisement of our peace was upon him. Anything that was disturbing your peace was upon him. So you don't need to suffer in fear and say, this sickness is disturbing my peace. Then the sickness is disturbing your peace, it was laid on Jesus. Hallelujah. What is the gospel? That he was wounded for our transgressions. I like that. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes were healed. Look at verse 6. I feel someone needs to hear this afternoon. That all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own ways. The Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He has laid upon him, not upon us. So don't let the devil, and even if you made a mistake before you entered this hall, even if you made a mistake before you started watching this message, Father, I'm sorry, and you are born again. 1 John 1, 9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just, forgives our sins and declares from righteousness. The Father, I'm sorry, forgive me in the name of Jesus. I confess, I judge myself, that thing was wrong. I call it wrong, I judge it wrong. Forgive me in Jesus' name. That is all. Jesus has paid the price. You don't have to roll on the floor. Some think, wait, I have to do penance. I have to roll on the floor. I'm sure I'm repentant. I have to roll on the floor. Where's, no, that all that does not mean anything. This, because I told you, well, all I'm doing is I'm trying to build that side of faith. The degree of power, the word is already anointed, so there's already power to get you healed. But faith gives action to that power in God's word. Hallelujah. Praise God. Romans chapter 5. Let me just take, well, therefore, being just, verse 1, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. By whom also we have access by faith to the grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we glory in tribulations. Why do we rejoice when we face problems? Because tribulation worketh patience. Continue, verse 4, please. Tribulation worketh patience. And patience expense and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. Verse 6. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. So if you were ungodly, you qualify. Jesus died for you. Hallelujah. And if you are not born again, you are no longer ungodly, but the devil can be bringing things back to your mind. Except Jesus paid the price for it. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Verse 7. Hallelujah. Praise God. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commended his love towards us, that while we are yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For he, when we were enemies, were reconciled to God through the death of his son. How much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Look at what he's saying in verse 10. When we were enemies, imagine I was your enemy. Your son now says, you were my enemy. My son now says, okay, to make us friends, maybe he's going to forfeit a great privilege so that we'll become friends. Say, Daddy, except you are friend with this Mommy, I'm not going, this auntie, I'm going to forfeit this benefit so that I become friends with him. But I'll say, why we were enemies? But now imagine I'm the one that now tells my son, okay, dad, why I'm fighting with this woman is because of a land that I've willed to you. I've said yours, the land belongs to you where I live. Maybe it's in my tama. I say, and she's claiming she owns the land too, but I know it's mine. But give it to her, forfeit the property so that we can become friends. Forfeit the rights, forfeit the property. Maybe it's already a good duplex, maybe a six-bedroom duplex in my tama with swimming pool and lawn tennis court. But I have documents that it is mine. But she's claiming it is hers also. She's claiming. And because we have, and I'm saying, let there be no strife among us. My son, yes, that's where we were planning to move to as you were getting married. Forget it. We'll go and rent an apartment and we'll say for you. Hallelujah. Forget it. So that we can be friends. But I'm the one that initiated it. The Bible says, why we're enemies? God reconciled us to himself through the death of his son. God initiated redemption. And part of that redemption is that he was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement of your peace was upon him. With his stripes you have been healed. God initiated it. He said, when we were enemies, you were fighting. You were ready to fight to Supreme Court. And we have not even gone to the first court. To the doctor. And we were ready to, I'm going to fight this thing with you to Supreme Court. And I called my son. I said, don't worry, I'm not going to fight her. I said, give her the house. Give her the deed, everything. Go and rent the house and we'll see. While we were enemies, it was God that reconciled us to himself through the death of his son. That now being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Now that we are reconciled, now that we have become friends, if you need security in that place and have the authority of security, if she now says that, this man, he didn't even fight me. He actually forfeited the thing for me. And people are disturbing her there, and she just lets me know. I'll say, the thing that I forfeited for her, I will send security to help her. You understand what I'm saying? Now that we have reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So God was the one that initiated the whole plan that it was to make sure that Jesus was wounded for your transgression. But he preached the Father to bruise him. He had made it was he pleased the Father to bruise him. It pleased the Father because of you to bruise him. Say, when he shall make his offering and his soul an offering for sin, God was the one that made his soul an offering for sin for you. So there is no reason why you should not take your healing. Hallelujah. Amen. So that's why he's saying God was the one that was reconciling us to himself in Christ Jesus. He said, if we were enemies, we're reconciled to God to the death of much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. We shall be absolutely free because of his life. Now look at verse 12. We're still going to Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Let me just come down to verse 14. Verse 15. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For he calls it a free gift. That part of that free gift is healing, is part of redemption. For if through the choice offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, has abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. Look at now verse 7. We read verse 7 together. For if by the one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. Don't let's use the word righteousness. People get confused. Let's use the word justification. They which receive the abundance of grace and the gift of justification. You are reigning in life by Christ Jesus. Shall reign in life by Christ Jesus. When you know you have been justified, it's a free gift. They that receive the abundance of grace and the gift of justification. You can walk in and take your healing. You can say himself took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses. It's a free gift. It is mine. Because part of that justification, he said, if we were enemies through the death of his son, now being reconciled, we have been saved totally by his life. So no matter the infirmity, we have received the gift of justification. Some people don't understand what I just said. This is what justification. We have been justified. We have been discharged and acquitted and made free. So what remains for you but praise? Hallelujah. Then that sickness should not reign over your body anymore. Sickness should not, because he said you have been justified, you have received the gift of justification. Because of one man, Verse 17 again, after the count of three, please. For he by one man's offense, death reigned by one, much more they which receive the abundance of grace and the gift of justification shall reign as kings in this life by Christ Jesus. Why I want to bring out that we have received the gift of justification. So sickness should not reign over, you should reign over it. We have received it. What does that mean? You can walk in the verse, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. You can come boldly and say, Father, you've provided healing for me in righteousness, in redemption. I take it now in the name of Jesus. And you walk away from there, I'm healed. You never had referred to yourself as a sick before. I was a sick, but I'm now healed. You can walk away immediately. Hebrews chapter 4, he said, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 to 16. Still keep your hands in Romans 5. We're going to keep reading now Romans 5 till we close. Hebrews chapter 4, we have received the gift of justification. We have been declared and acquitted in the court of heaven. Verse 14. Seeing then, Hebrews 4, 14 to 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we are not an high priest that can, which cannot be taught with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He can be touched. He said, because he can be touched, he said, let us therefore come boldly. He understands. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy. And healing is part of the mercies of God. Remember what Bartimaeus said. He says, Jesus, thou son of David, do what? Have mercy on me. So his blind eyes were opened because of mercy. He said, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So it might be condemnation that is hindering your faith, because the degree of faith and the degree of power applied will get you. Now we have removed that condemnation. Come boldly and take it. Thank you, Father, because healing is mine. Because it was while I was your enemy that you gave it to me. You paid the price for it. So I thank you, Father, because I'm healed. You can take, just like you go to God and say, Father, I know I'm a sinner. You preach the gospel to you one day, and someone preached to you and you said, Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know you sent your son Jesus to die for my sins. He rose on the third day for my righteousness. I now confess and accept Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. If you do that, you are saved. The greatest miracle that can ever happen in life, on earth, in heaven and earth, happens immediately that person does that. He becomes a new creature because he took the death of a member of the Godhead to make that possible. You become a new creature. He said, Eve, why we were enemies, God reconciled us to himself. We were enemies when he came to look, like she was fighting me, ready to go to Supreme Court. And I just tell my son behind the back, don't mind her, give her everything. Eve, why we were, because I'm not an enemy, I'm a friend. Hallelujah. Eve, why we were enemies, we reconciled to God through the death of his son. How much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Those that have received the abundance of grace and the gift of justification, the gift of righteousness, shall reign as kings in this life by Christ Jesus. To be justified, to be made righteous, means to be discharged and acquitted. To be called not guilty. So God is not saying you are guilty. Stop looking at your past that I'm guilty. That's why this, even if it was your foolishness that made it come upon you, he said, even fools, because of their iniquities and their transgressions, they are afflicted. They cry unto the Lord in their trouble. He saves them out of their distress. Even when they, he said, and he sends his word and heal them. And delivers them from their destruction. Even when it was because of their iniquities and their transgressions that they were afflicted. It was because of their sins they were afflicted, though. He said, but they still cried unto the Lord in their troubles. Hallelujah. Glory. And he saved them out of their distress. He saves them out of their distress. Psalm 107, verse 19 and 20, quickly. From 17 to 20. He saves them, so I don't care. I'm so glad I'm saved. Oh, I'm so glad I'm saved. That salvation means healing for my body. Hallelujah. I told you the gospel is anointed. The man in Lystra only heard the gospel. Psalm 17, from verse 17. Psalm 107 from verse 17. Fools, because of their iniquities. Because of their transgression, because of their iniquities, are afflicted. Verse 18. They are so labose all manner of me. That means this man is so sick that he's near, yeah, and they draw near unto the gates of death. This man, because of sin, is so sick that he's about to die. He has lost his appetite. Look at verse 19. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble. This was under the Old Testament too. under an old covenant that had condemnation, a ministration of condemnation. They cried unto the Lord in their trouble. That at the ministration of that Old Testament was condemnation. No? They still cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress. Verse 20. Oh, glory to God. He sent his word. His name is Jesus. And healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Look at verse 21. That's all we should be doing. He said, oh, that man will praise the Lord. Oh, that man will praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. They that receive the abundance of grace and the gift of justification. This gift of being discharged and acquitted. I don't care what you did. What is making you depressed? That it's because I did this. I have good news for you. Jesus died because of it. He said the chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes we were healed. All we like sheep had gone astray. We had turned every man to his own way. The Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. The iniquity of us all. So you are free to take your healing. He said because he can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy. Oh, glory to God. Let's come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy. And find grace to help in time of need. So whatever has been stopping you before, we've removed that roadblock now. Go bold, you can go boldly. Your word says I'm healed and I take it. Glory to God. Praise his holy name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, just give him praise. Father, we give you praise and glory. I'm saved because of you. Hallelujah. We give him. I'm healed just because of you. Hallelujah. Father, we give you praise. Oh, fradiste kriandere motahake. Estufraniste niangre no sofrakite haka. Rabobose frikiti brakalifro dozi. Rimanongre historia andarie sostile braka. Rombengis tumblange talisto brekia. Osia sasusteria turobosia. Ribabose freketista. We give you praise. We give you glory. Ribabose frekeria sastireba. E prakardiso sombreka. E prakardisa sikla pota frekardisia. Remanonde histolo vota. Glory to your name, Matisto Romosia, pa. E prakatisto radisteria terabotia. Oh, fradisto riendaraba. Hallelujah, pradiste riendaramota. Thank you, Father God. I'm saved because of you. Hallelujah. You don't need to be in distress at all. Hallelujah. You don't need to worry yourself. Look to the one that died on the cross. He died for you and for me. Praise God. And his sacrifice has paid it all. Father, we give you praise. We exalt you for your good. For your mercies endure forever. My Lord, just thank you. Father, we are so grateful. Because of Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah. We give you praise and glory. Hallelujah. He that did not spare his only son, but gave him up for us. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Is he a brand new breast? Is he a brand new kidney? Is he a brand new liver? How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Stop looking at the circumstance, how far the affliction has gone. Look at the one that has come with grace and mercy to help you. Hallelujah. Stop looking at how far the sickness has gone. With just one clip, one blinking of twinkling of an eye, everything can become new. Hallelujah. Because it's all because of Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, the old man, Jesus died for us that we might live. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. So rejoice and be glad and rest in his promises and take your healing. Because he's a good father. Father, we give you praise and glory. We exhort you for your good, for your mercies and dear Father Lord. Thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. If you are here watching me, you are not born again, you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I would like you to say this after me. Because if you have not accepted Jesus, all I'm talking about does not begin to you. Hallelujah. Say, Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know you sent your son Jesus to die for my sins. On the third day, he rose for my righteousness. I now confess and accept Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Never forget what we are doing. We are showing ourselves from God's word. That God's word is powerful and there is healing in the gospel. And with faith in the gospel, you will take your healing. Hallelujah. And what is faith? Is simply acting as if God's word is true. Acting on God's word as though he did not lie. We'll continue tomorrow. We'll minister to the sick by the grace of God, so led by the Spirit tomorrow. And the next week we'll continue also. Praise God. Stay with us these next 2 weeks to the end of September. We are focusing on methods of obtaining healing. And as we share those methods, as God leads us, removing some roadblocks. We just removed one this afternoon. Glory to God. Amen. See you again next week. Tomorrow. There's